Humans have enlisted animals to help fight their wars since prehistoric times, and some of the world's earliest historical sources tell of battles between ancient warlords in horse-drawn chariots. Dogs and horses were probably the first animals used in war, and many are still used today. But an even wider range of creatures have been used to fight human battles throughout history. Today we will discuss some of the most bizarre historical uses of animals in war.
That was powerful.
Damn. Has that ever been done on a podcast?
That was like we had a message.
I feel like podcasts never do that.
That was like church.
I feel like rule number one of podcasts is never talk over each other.
We were harmonizing.
I think we might have just changed the game.
I mean, that was powerful.
Damn.
People tuned in and they were like, whoa, gotta listen to this. Welcome to Little Laughs. My name's Jimmy. Gross, that's Jake. Man. We're talking about animals and war. On the last Little Laughs, we talked about Chat-a-me. A pigeon that saved people's lives. A hero pigeon that saved people's lives. Now we're talking about a bunch of other animals that have been used in war. And we're coming to you live from the Roosevelt Studios. That's RSVLTS. And I think, you know, maybe they'll have a line of shirts of war animals soon.
They probably could. They probably could. I'd get a Chat-a-me shirt. That story changed my life.
Yeah.
Someone reached out on Twitter and told us what Chat-a-me meant because you guys asked what the wire was called Chat-a-me. Dear friend.
Sure was.
In French.
Yeah. Sure. I don't know if you'd send your dear friend into a firefight of bullets.
It's a dear friend to them.
Okay. Animal number one, Jake. Cattle.
Is that an animal?
It's a herd of one animal.
Okay.
Stampeding cattle are one of nature's irresistible forces. Mm. They have been used many times in the history of warfare in attempts to crush opposing forces, but often with mixed results. At the Battle of Tondibi in West Africa in 1591.
Wow. Big battle.
The defending army of the Songhai Empire opened the engagement with a charge of 1,000 stampeding cattle against the lines of Moroccan infantry, a tactic that had worked in the past against enemies who had no guns. Jesus. But the Moroccans did have guns, which spooked the cattle.
Okay, good twist right there.
The creature stampeded back into the Songhai army. Ooh. Who lost the battle and eventually lost control of their entire empire. So they sent the cattle, and if they didn't have guns, you know, you just get stampeded to death like Mufasa.
Yeah.
But they were like just shot a couple shots, and then the cattle turned around and stampeded the original army. Is that what happened here?
Yeah.
Yeah, so they charged, couple gunshots, animals got scared by that noise, and then they turned on... Yeah, they're on a good backfire, Jim. You like a good backfire.
Do you know the Songhai army may have not known they had guns and had like, holy smokes, they can control the animals. they turned their own animals against us.
Yeah, they thought
just mind control.
Their god had turned against them.
I've seen enough war movies to know that if you're about to get stampeded by animals, you just dig a ditch.
If you're about to get stampeded by animals, you just dig a ditch. Yeah.
I mean, you got to know they're coming, though.
Yeah. Well, you hear them coming, you dig a ditch.
Got to dig quick, man.
How fast can cows run?
I don't know. I mean, well, producer Luke will look that up. I mean, cattle also includes, like, steers and stuff, right? They're, like, powerful and...
Cows can run 25 miles per hour.
I was expecting faster.
Really?
Yeah.
No way. And I think that's like the fastest cow ever.
Yeah.
That's like if cows Googled humans and they were like, how fast could humans run? And be like, Usain Bolt runs at 33 miles per hour. And the cows would be like, no.
C- cattle?
No, it says the average speed is 25 miles per hour.
Those are the fast ones.
Cattle is defined as large ruminant animals with horns and cloven hooves. Mm. Domesticated for meat or milk.
Gross.
And then it just says cows at the end. So maybe it is only cows.
Domesticated for meat or milk.
That's all right, next up. Yeah. Well,
yeah.
There's still one more section on cattle.
Oh, I know. That guy, I'm getting there.
Oh.
In 1861, I read that date just all wrong, Jake.
Okay.
Like, so in 1671.
Oh, my God.
Staring at the date. I got so many of the numbers wrong. In 1671, the Welsh buccaneer, Henry Morgan, you remember him from earlier episodes, led an army of 1,000 pirates and freebooters to attack the Spanish colony of Panama City. The Panamanians, that's such a cool...
Yeah.
That's such a cool term.
Pretty dope.
I'm a Panamanian. Had only 1,200 troops. Seems fair. 1,000 versus 1,200 to defend the city. But they also deployed a herd of 2,400 wild cattle, which I don't understand. You know, right. If you're herding them and then sending them somewhere, they don't seem that wild. They seem like you have control over them, which they planned to stampede into the pirate army. But the pirates stationed themselves between a patch of swampland, which made the Panamanian cavalry and cattle charges impossible. The wild bulls were finally released late in the battle, but the pirates managed to divert the stampede by waving rags at the charging bulls and eventually shot down all the poor beasts with muskets. Jeez. The Morgan and the pirate army went on to capture and sack Panama City, which burned down a few days later after several mysterious fires broke out. It was rumored that Morgan himself ordered the city to be burned so his drunken pirate army would be forced to move on elsewhere. Is this Captain Morgan?
Is this Captain Morgan? I think that's...
Gotta be, right?
...the question we're all wondering.
Caribbean,
yeah.
Rum, Captain Morgan.
Modeled after that. Kind of love that. You know, let's burn this place down and go somewhere else. Just doesn't feel right.
Yeah.
Bad memories here.
They probably didn't like the... Yeah, Henry Morgan, Captain Morgan. They probably didn't like the swamps.
Swampland, that's pretty good defense. That's kind of like the digging a ditch thing you referenced. It's a water ditch.
Yeah, basically. It's in a lot of war movies as well.
It's a water ditch.
Meet us in the mud.
I mean, we're starting to see the flaws with using animals in wars when the way to beat them was waving rags.
That's a good way to win a war against like a toddler, too.
Sure.
Well, the next...
You don't see a lot of toddlers in battle anymore.
Well...
I don't.
Not since...
I don't.
The next animal we're going to do is bats.
Bats.
The bat bomb.
Bang.
Was a bizarre experimental weapon developed by the U.S. military during World War II.
Oh, that sucks.
Is it because, like, the Japanese had caves and stuff, so they would just send a bunch of bats in there? To start thousands of fires in cities.
You asked a question.
It's a good question.
I don't know. Next. Okay,
next. Designed to start thousands of fires in cities across Japan in retribution for the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor, the bat bomb plan called for 1,000 live bats, obviously.
Obviously. The dead bat bomb was a failure.
Yeah.
They tried that at first. Jeez. It's just dead bats?
These aren't going to harm us.
Touché. There's got to be something else coming. They sent the dead bat bomb, they were on high
yeah,
alert.
Yeah.
They
What's
were on
this?
High
What's
alert.
This?
Nobody sleeps.
There's one bat, like, kind of alive, and they're like, tell us.
Mm.
Bats can't talk. With a tiny incendiary device fitted to each bat. They put bombs on the bats. They had kamikaze bats. Is that what you're telling me?
I don't think incendiary necessarily means bomb.
I think... To some extent, it does.
To some extent, it does?
It means...
I want the exact definition.
What, are they just dressing them up?
No, incendiary means, like, fire.
Designed to cause fire. So they lit the bats on fire. I just don't think bomb is the right term.
Firebomb, whatever.
Fire bats.
Well, finish and then...
Okay. They taped matchsticks to the bat, lit them, and sent them. Someone had to put dressed 1,000 bats up with fire vests.
That's gross.
All 1,000 bats would then be housed inside a casing that could be dropped from a U.S. warplane over Japan. That pilot just flying a plane full of bats.
Dude, I would be interested in this, and maybe Luke and Noah should note this. But all of the positions in war that get overlooked, like the guy who flew the bats, the guy that taped stuff to the bats, there's a lot of noble war positions that don't get mentioned.
I just put a picture of...
Oh, dude, tell me this isn't a bomb that they taped to the bat.
That's the incendiary device.
I mean, that very well could be.
And then this is the container that the bats were in. It looks like a missile.
Nightmare, man.
Looks like the bats would just die on impact. Why didn't you just put the bombs in that case?
Just put the bombs in the bomb.
You can leave the bats out of this plan.
Just drop the bomb.
All 1,000 bats are housed inside the casing that we just saw. It just looks like a tube of a missile. The idea was that the bats and their attached incendiaries would then seek wooden Japanese homes and buildings to roost in.
Oh, my God.
Where they would kindle fires for the war effort.
It's kind of fucked.
So that answers your bombing question.
They just tied kindling to the bats?
It wasn't like exploding on impact. It was like some kind of device that after the bats had settled and into houses throughout Japan, then fires would erupt throughout the whole country.
Someone overthought it. I'll be honest.
The guy who came up with the bat bomb plan.
They went two steps too far.
Is psycho. He was doing Benny's. He was drugged up. They put some guys into a room, the U.S. military.
Yeah.
And we're like, we need 20 ideas of how to beat the Japanese. And they.
Can't believe bat bomb
for
won.
For 2 weeks, they didn't have anything.
All right. So I have more information than this.
What happened was, Jake.
Wait. No, we're telling you what happened.
Yeah, the guy who thought of bat bomb couldn't get over it. Like, they were like trying, like. And they said this phrase, I can't get over the bat bomb.
See, I'm going to disagree with you. I think bat bomb was the clear winner, and I want to know the other 19 ideas. What came below bat bomb?
Regular bomb?
I don't know. Luke, you seem to have some fake information of your own.
Yeah, I almost did a full episode on this because it's really crazy, but the guy who invented it was a Pennsylvania dentist. And he was vacationing.
Suicidal.
He was vacationing in Wyoming and saw the caves there, and then thought of the idea. But he also was famous because after this scheme,
dude saw caves in Wyoming and said, "We can send bats to the Japanese with bombs tied to them."
Yeah.
Yeah.
Weirdo.
Yes.
He also tried to garner interest in a fried chicken vending machine. That was his next invention after the bat bomb.
He's an ideas man.
He is.
Wow.
I respect that.
The bat bomb plan seems to have been taken seriously, mainly because it was thought up by a friend of U.S. First Lady Eleanor Roosevelt.
Eleanor.
The plan received approval from President Roosevelt in 1942, and the U.S. military went on to spend more than $2 million trying to get it to work. More than 6,000 bats were used in the bat bomb test. Most of them plunged straight to the ground or just flew away. But they did manage to set fire to a simulated Japanese village. Okay, simulated it. A U.S. Army hangar and a general's car before the program was abandoned. I mean, how pissed was Franklin at Eleanor? Hey, you know your friend's plan?
Yeah.
It sucks. The whole military is laughing at me for putting it in place.
The whole thing's terrible.
They're calling it Eleanor's bad plan.
That's so dumb.
Next up, elephants. We've talked about this.
This is the money one here.
Talked about this in Civil War.
And I mean, you know, you watch the movie 300. If you've seen the size of an elephant, you're like, okay, yes.
And if you haven't seen, they're big.
They're big.
Elephants, the largest land mammals on Earth, made their mark in ancient warfare as creatures capable of devastating packed formations of enemy troops. Elephants can trample enemy soldiers. They can gore them with their tusks and even throw them with their trunks. They were often armored against enemy weapons or had their tusks tipped with iron spikes. Some even carried a raised fighting platform on their back for archers and javelin throwers. Badass.
Can you... I know it's been depicted in movies and stuff, whether fantasy and some not. Could you imagine early times, and say you've never seen an elephant before, and an elephant rolls through.
And if you
through,
haven't, they're big gray creatures
right,
with long trunks.
Reminder.
Noses, yeah.
An elephant comes through with people on it. It's got spikes on its fucking tusks. And there's archers and javelins and shit. Like, that'd be kind of a good way to die back then.
What's the equivalent to how crazy it was to them then? To
be
us
like
now?
UFOs. Like, it's if like you, if you've never seen an elephant, it's the equivalent of a UFO. If you have, you're just like, they beat us. They're smarter than us.
How are we going to beat those things?
These things are huge.
They're that fucking giant horse. That, at yeah. one point, someone said that.
Giant horse.
Giant mutant horse was yeah. like, what? It cannot be that.
One guy...
Horse with a dick nose.
One guy in, like, the opposing army was pretending they heard that the other army was going to come with elephants, and his friend was asking him, like, what is an elephant? And he's like, it's like a big horse. And then they come, and the guy's like, that was not a big horse.
Yeah, it was bigger. Luke, imagine that you have a penis where your nose is, and you sneeze.
Okay.
I think I'm just going to get, like, three pizzas.
Pocket.
We'll circle up.
Just
later.
Finish it, because we'll you've been scrolling on that phone for so long. Well, I know nothing's going to get
finalized. I was debating if we should get other stuff. Then I was like, if we get a chicken sandwich and everyone else is eating pizza, I think they're going to be looking at us like, oh, you got a chicken sandwich, but the common man eats pizza, so I'm just fucking eating
Can
pizza.
You get a different pizza place?
Yes. Where'd we go last time?
Justin's, I think.
Okay, I got a different
it
pizza
place. It was good, but it was like you ate one slice and you're like, I'm disgusting.
What do you want?
Now. Whatever.
Okay.
All right, back
to
the
war. Are we leaving
ward.
That in?
Sure.
I think so.
That was us ordering food for game night. Persian, there's a lot of elephant stories. I feel like they're all the same. Elephants breed slowly, and the captive herds were small, so wild males were usually caught and trained to be war elephants. In 1331 BC, the invading armies of Alexander the Great encountered the war elephants of the Persian Empire for the first time at the Battle of Gwagabala.
Nailed it.
The elephants terrified Alexander's soldiers, but that didn't stop them from winning the battle. Oh! And soon Alexander added all of Persia's war elephants to his own forces. That's a big miss for elephants in war. They lost their first. Like, we just spent a lot of time talking about the element of surprise when you see your first war elephant and how you'd be so scared. Alexander the Great's crew didn't even flinch.
Yeah.
They were like, bam, 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 thanks. We'll take your elephants now.
Yeah, and that's you know, you always have to learn. There's a
learning
curve.
Maybe there were some, like, generals that were like, they were using them wrong.
Or when you always picture wars from those times, you picture, like, castles and they have a big wall up or something. Like, imagine the elephants just, like, just brought them there. And then there's nothing.
There's, like, hanging out outside.
Yeah.
Sleeping in the grass and stuff.
Yeah. Trolling around.
Doing, like, standing on their front
legs.
Doing,
like,
cute
dog stuff. There's, like, a puddle and they're spraying mud.
Look at that giant dog.
It's a good time.
In 2080 BC, before Christ, the king...
280.
Yeah, in 280 BC, the king Pars of Epirus borrowed more than 20 African war elephants from the Egyptian king Pars II.
Ptolemy.
To attack the armies of Rome at the Battle of Heracla in southern Italy.
Heraclea.
The elephants helped to rout the Romans, but by the time of the Battle of Asculum...
Yeah, I bet.
The next year, the Romans had developed anti-elephant wagons covered in iron spikes, and troopers were specifically trained to attack the elephants with javelins. Oh, man. Yeah. Pyrrhus also won the battle against Rome, with huge losses among his troops, giving rise to the term a pyrrhic victory. That's a term?
You never heard it?
No.
Same.
Works
out. Next up, bears.
Bears. Oh my god. I think we gotta start chucking if this is a little less. I didn't realize how many animals there are.
I'll speed read bears.
Oh boy.
And then we'll talk about it afterwards. Bears appear a few times in the history of warfare, but one bear in particular became famous for his exploits against the Germans during World War II. Wojtek was a Syrian brown bear cub adopted by troops from a Polish supply company who purchased him while they were stationed in Iran. The bear grew up drinking condensed milk from a vodka bottle and drinking beer. When the Polish troops were moved around as the war progressed, Wojtek went to battle zones in Iraq, Palestine, Egypt, and Italy. Have you heard about him? He's very famous.
I have. I've seen, if you like any of the history Instagram type accounts or something, he's going to pop up once a month.
He's very famous. Yeah. Stood more than 6 feet tall, weighed more than 880 pounds. In time, he was enlisted as a private soldier in the supply company with his own paybook rank. Why were they paying him?
I'm guessing someone had to keep eyes on Wojtek the bear.
You think? And he just woke up and showed up to...
I'm guessing Wojtek had a close buddy that was helping with his funds.
That really means that someone got paid extra for taking care of Wojtek.
I'll say this. I'm pretty dumb. I would have been like, let the bear fight. him carrying all the heavy ammo, that's genius.
Yeah.
Genius.
He's strong. I hope they paid him. I hope they paid him poorly, to be honest with you.
Yeah, that's true. I don't think they paid him well.
It's a war crime. In later years, Wojtek went to the zoo.
Appeared on TV shows and stuff. Good for Wojtek.
He became a public figure. Well, wasn't he Russian? Like, in Russia, they train these bears. They, like, make them docile at youth. And you ever seen the videos of people driving around Russia with just brown bears in their cars, like pets and stuff? It's really weird. Bees. You mean like bees on the field?
Jesus, bees have a big history.
The ancient Greeks and Romans are among many ancient peoples known to have used bees as tiny weapons of war. Attackers would sometimes catapult beehives over the walls of besieged cities and the defenders of Themyscira, a Greek town famous for its production of honey, defeated the attacking Romans in 72 BC by sending swarms of bees through the mines that have been dug. This is awesome. That's a great call.
Nuts.
That's my favorite one so far. Someone throws a beehive at you? Oh, brutal.
While you're stuck in a mine, too? Yeah. No escape. You can't just like run and swat.
It's nightmare stuff.
Grenades probably would have worked better, but they didn't have them yet, Jake.
Oh, your tunnel under the city. Please. Here's the bees.
Snakes and bees?
Place the bees.
And a skunk in there to eat the bees?
Doubt they traveled with a skunk.
You would doubt that.
We would have had a skunk chapter by now.
The Romans seem to have especially bad history with bees. What a funny sentence.
Yeah.
Who has a good history with bees?
Not I.
Beekeepers.
In 69 BC, the Heptacomites of Turkey tricked invading soldiers under the command of the Roman general Pompey by leaving hives filled with poisoned honey along the route of their march. Chemists now think the poison was a granotoxin that can form in honey, which is rarely lethal to humans but makes them very sick. And the Heptacomites were able to easily defeat the vomiting, intoxicated Romans. So they just got them sick.
That one's weird to me. They littered the walkway to their city with beehives, and the Romans were like, "Huh, this is awesome. There's just so much honey for us."
The Romans were just walking around like Winnie the Pooh, just like fingering the dust off the top of the wall, and be like, "Oh, it's honey, not dust."
So,
hey, we're all sick. You think it was that honey strategically placed on our route to battle?
So,
this paints the Romans in a dumb light.
I very much get your argument here.
Okay.
They had a bad history with bees.
But
you're eating the honey.
Yes, we're all eating the honey. Let's be honest. We're traveling there for war. Rations aren't good.
No, the Romans, historically great rations.
You see some honey, like you think it's a sign from the gods. That literally the nectar of the gods.
Not if it's just placed on the walkway.
You're eating the honey.
It's got to be attached.
I need you to know
like,
you're eating the
It's got to be attached still.
Because I'm eating that honey.
At the Battle of Tenga in German East Africa, now Kenya... German East Africa is a terrible name.
Yeah.
Kenya's way cooler. During World War I, both the invading British forces and the defending Germans were attacked on the battlefield by swarms of angry bees, which caused the British attack to fail when a swarm drove off one of their infantry regiments. British propaganda from the time portrayed the bee attack as a fiendish German plot that used tripwires to aggravate the hives of the insects. That's cool.
I do like that.
It's cool. I'm into the bee attack.
Oh, I like the British playing it cool. I think the bees were accidental here. Both sides were attacked by bees in this one. But the British just played it off like it was a devious German move.
Yeah. Motivation.
Motivation. I like
that. During the Vietnam War in the 60s and 70s, Viet Cong guerrillas were said to have carefully relocated wild hives of the Asian giant honeybee along the trails used by enemy patrols. One fighter would wait nearby until the patrol approached before setting off a firework near the hive to aggravate the bees and attack the enemy soldiers. Basic to basic.
Yeah.
Just shoot the soldiers.
The Asian giant honeybee.
Being the guy who has to relocate all of those hives also sounds like the worst job
ever.
Again,
whose gig was that? That guy's not in the history books.
No. We got three left. Dolphins. The U.S. Navy has been training bottlenose dolphins to carry out marine patrols since the 1960s. After they were identified for their intelligence and military aptitude in a program of tests of 19 different types of animals, including birds and sharks, a dolphin's main military asset is its precise echolocation sense, which lets it identify objects underwater that would be invisible to human divers. Dolphins can also use their eyes underwater, but by emitting a series of high-pitched squeaks,
there's some,
and listening for the echoes that bounce back, they can make a mental image of objects. Like the reboot of Flipper with Elias, what's his name?
Sonar.
Frodo?
Yes.
What's that actor's name?
Elijah Wood.
Yeah, and the girl from Boy Meets World that I had a crush on, the dolphins just do this all the time. They, you know, help out. Yeah, Flipper was
like
great.
It's like how they see.
Yeah, Flipper was great at this.
Yeah.
U.S. Navy dolphins are also deployed with teams of human handlers on patrols of Navy harbors and other shipping areas to look for threats such as marine mines or limpet bombs attached to the hulls of warships. The dolphins are trained to spot strange objects, report back to their human handlers with a type of yes and no response.
I'm going to go with the up and down as the yes response.
Now, in Flipper, they had a yes buoy and a no buoy.
Okay,
and
I could see that,
yes
too.
And the no.
I could see that, too.
Yeah, so I think it's historically accurate now that I come to think about it.
Yeah.
These mind-marking abilities came in handy during the Persian Gulf War and in the Iraq War, when Navy dolphins helped clear mines from the port of Qafah in southern Iraq. U.S. Navy dolphins are also trained to help people having difficulty in the water and to locate enemy divers or swimmers and try to mate with them. Mm. But the Navy denies rumors it has trained dolphins to attack. Next up is mosquitoes.
Qasar.
Yeah. You never been?
I have not been there.
To Qasar?
I've got... So something kind of brought me down in the dolphin part.
Okay. Was it that they have sex with people?
I think dolphins have been slaughtered underwater.
By who?
Dude, if the U.S. Navy's using dolphins, that means any dolphin that they don't know could be a dolphin of the other guys, and vice versa.
You think there's a dolphin war going on?
I think both sides are killing dolphins. Imagine, okay... So you're
time out. Are the humans killing the dolphins, yes, or are the dolphins battling underwater?
I wish the dolphins were battling. They've definitely had talks. Yeah. Dolphins are smart. Yeah. But okay, you're with the U.S. military, and you're out in the ocean with your dolphin who's supposed to be scouting for you.
Picture them in uniforms.
And then you see another dolphin. Like, what do you think that dolphin's doing?
Just chilling.
He's spying. Like, that's your thought process. They were mowing down dolphins.
Tagging them with a little, like... Just decorating the fin with a flag. It's cool.
It'd be pretty badass.
Then you got decoy dolphins. You put, like, the American flag on the dumb ones.
Yeah, I could see that.
Dolphin wars.
Oh.
Mosquitoes. Jake's favorite. Late in World War II, the German military forces in control of Italy ordered the flooding of the Pontine marshes south of Rome in an effort to create a malaria-filled swamp that would slow the Allied advance. The marshes had been drained in a major development project in the 20s and 30s, but after Italy changed sides in 43 and German forces took control of the country, they ordered the pumps that kept the marshes under control to be stopped. That was a big strategy. That was like part of the strategy to fuck over paratroopers on D-Day, too. They flooded the swamps where the U.S. paratroopers land. I don't know. I think mosquitoes were a side effect.
Mm.
They were so paratroopers would land in water and shit. Like, that's what they did. Soon the marshes started to fill with brackish water, which pro-Nazi scientists had foretold would encourage the return of the malarial mosquito species Anopheles lapronchia to the marshes, as well as causing long-term damage to the agriculture of the region. I'm calling bullshit here. I think they flooded them for...
I mean, I think this is information, though.
Tangible things. They wanted malaria mosquitoes back? They don't choose who the mosquito bites.
Well, that's the end result. But I think the Germans were hoping it would get more of the bad guys.
Yeah.
In their eyes.
It affected both sides in the end.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then the last one we have here is scorpions. The Roman armies faced an enemy even worse than bees when they besieged the... Atrinians at the city of Hatra in modern-day Iraq. in 198 BC. According to ancient accounts, the Atrinians seem to have perfected a method of handling scorpions without endangering themselves, which allowed them to fill clay pots with dozens of the stinging creatures and hurl them down on the attacking Romans. Damn.
I kind of like that. That's got two effects there.
Imagine getting hit with a clay pot and that not being the worst thing that happened
right.
to you. Like, oh, shit, it was Ooh. Filled with scorpions.
That hurt, but... Oh,
yeah.
By the way, we need to go back to, like, the Atrinians at the city of Hatra.
Yeah.
Can we bring that back? That's awesome.
Like, the New Yorkers in the city of New York?
That's not cool, though.
Panamanians.
So how do you want to do it? Give me an American
like
city.
Like, those don't link up. Do you see what I'm saying? Atrinians and Hatra.
Well, I think the Atrinians aren't from Hatra. They're invading.
They besieged the Atrinians at Hatra. So who are they? The Hatras?
Maybe oh, Hatra. Right, is, right, maybe right. Hatra is pronounced Atra. The H is silent, so it's Atrinians Hatra.
Why would you get rid of it in the Atrinians if you're going to keep it in the city?
Someone lost in translation, Jake.
That's all I'm saying.
Well, when they threw the clay pots with the scorpions, it says the insects fell into the Romans' eyes.
I guess you could do it in Texas, like.
And on all the unprotected parts of their bodies.
The Texans in the city of Houston.
The Yankees.
Like, that works.
Hmm.
Connecticutites.
Like, that doesn't work, but. Okay.
The insects fell into the Romans' eyes and on all the unprotected parts of their bodies.
Wrote Herodian of Syria? See? That fucking guy. In the 3rd century AD...
What does it mean they fell into their eyes?
Digging in before they were noticed, they bit and stung the soldiers.
Maximus, Maximus.
There's one more.
The hot climate and disease among the attackers did the rest, and the Romans eventually had to give up the siege of Hatra.
Yeah.
Bonus one.
Sea lions. U.S. Navy continues to train sea lions to locate and mark the locations of marine mines and other threats. Sea lions are no joke, man. Don't pet them if you see them in the wild.
Never have.
Just don't. They're not dogs of the sea.
Let's locate and mark. Again, this brings me back to my dolphin theory. Sea lions are getting shot down. Trained to attach a special leg cuff to human divers or saboteurs, which allows their handlers to haul the suspects to the surface.
Okay.
I think they're playing defense.
Nice.
That's a crazy line. Makes it sound like the seals, sea lions are going down, putting handcuffs on a diver and bringing them back to home base.
Imagine if that happened to you. I don't buy that. A sea lion.
I understand what you're saying.
A sea lion is swimming underwater.
Yeah.
Finding a human diver.
Bumping into him.
Handcuffing them with ease.
It never said
Sometimes
that.
Cops can't even handcuff people with ease. Like, the diver's like, ah, shit, sea lion, you got me. Here's my hands.
Well, I mean, a sea lion can move a lot faster than a human underwater. We agree on this.
Yeah, unless there's a scuba rocket.
So, well, listen to what you just said. You put a device on the sea lion that when it bumps into him, it collapses or connects or does something. And then the sea lion swims up and they got you. That's
what?
That's the worst 15 seconds of your life when that, the
what
sea lion gets
what
you.
What device is it?
I put a link to a YouTube video in the doc.
Of a sea lion capturing someone?
Sea lion harness also carries camera that can provide underwater feed. Yeah, just one sea lion, two handles, and a rubber boat can replace a Navy-sized vessel. Okay, well, we're clearly on the cuff. Luke has given us a video. I've got a commercial.
I got no commercial.
It's kind of a sad commercial.
The guy looks like Rob Riggle. I don't know if he's yelling, but he surely looks like him.
Dolphin and the guy give each other a salute.
Okay, the sea lion just jumped into the water, and there's a rope there, and there's another guy that's, like, laying on top of the water.
It does look like Rob Riggle.
Okay, now the sea lion is eating out of the guy's hand.
I can confirm that.
And now Rob Riggle's just talking, and it
now
never
he's
happened.
Kind of flaunting at the end.
It never happened?
No, it's a little bit in the video.
What part?
You finished it?
Yes.
We're clicking through, so we probably missed it. There's a guy in the water at one point.
Yeah, around 1:30.
Yeah, so we kind of skipped through that part.
But what do you mean? That guy was just floating there like, come get me, sea lion.
You see he has something attached to his leg at one point, though.
Yeah, the sea lion did not do that. I can guarantee you that.
Good job, sea lion. Thank you for protecting us.
I guess. I don't think whatever that was wasn't a sea lion capturing a human underwater.
It was a sea lion capturing a human. This was a practice run.
That was a pre-handcuffed guy.
He wasn't pre-handcuffed.
He got in the water, and then they were like, the sea lion got in the water. He's like, come here, pup. Come here, pup.
I mean, you
got
to do practice runs.
And they're not dogs of the sea, so.
That video made that thing look like a dog. It was like by his side healing and stuff underwater.
That's the trouble, Luke, because now you're going to see a sea lion in the wild think it's a friendly dog of the sea because of videos like that.
No, we have to ask about this. Our friend KT Sharp, that video we just watched was in Bahrain.
Oh, yeah.
She's been there. She's
that was probably
connected
a military
to the military.
Yeah.
Wonder if she's ever heard of it. So we'll look into that.
Thanks for tuning in to Little Laughs. You got anything else?
See ya.
I mean, the first article, when you look up sea lion handcuff, is sea lions help U.S. Navy handcuff enemy divers.
It's just not something I will believe easily.
I mean, I do believe it.
I think they're using the term handcuff loosely.
Do I think they're getting both of the divers' hands together in cuffs? No. Do I think they can attach themselves to that diver in some fashion? Yes.
That's what I need to know.
Okay. This
are they bathing themselves in like double-sided adhesive and then just touching someone?
There's one sentence in this article. The sea lion has also learned to attach leg cuffs to enemy divers, immobilizing them and allowing human sailors on the surface to pull in the intruders. So that makes me think more they're doing circles around the diver's feet with twine until he gets all jumbled.
So the humans have a diver captured like in a circular area. And then they send the sea lion and say, go fetch that human.
I think it's the opposite. I think the sea lion hooks the human, and then the humans reel them in.
Yes, but they have to find him physically. They're not just like, we think there's a diver under this water. Go get him. And then the sea lion dives in, and you have no idea what's going on top of the boat, and then he comes up with a human.
I mean, if you're asking, do I think there's sea lions that are living their life in the ocean, protecting and serving, no.
No, I'm saying like
these ones have to be trained for war.
The people,
and then
on,
when we're at war,
the
they
people,
release.
No,
them.
No, but I'm saying the people on the boat have to have eyes on the diver.
I don't think that's a huge part of it because you don't just say sea lion 060 dive, dive, dive. The sea lion doesn't know what that means. Still a sea lion.
The video we watched was a guy in water.
Get that video out of your head.
That was the military's video.
We'll have an update for you guys next time. Thank you.
Thanks. See ya. Thank you.